Hi, my name is Gabe. I'm a mathematician and a tutor, and I'm excited to dive into some statistics with you. This video will provide a general introduction to confidence intervals. We will begin by highlighting the difference between population parameters and sample statistics, and we will then introduce how confidence intervals fit into the dialogue between these parameters and sample statistics. Finally, we will discuss the general structure for constructing confidence intervals. Now, it might be a bold claim, but the world is a big place with a lot of people in it. Statisticians often find themselves wanting to describe groups at the scale of an entire population, which comes with some challenges. For example, perhaps someone wants to describe the average height of the entire population of Earth. Now, the most accurate way to measure the average height of the population would be to measure the height of every single person, add those heights up, and divide by the population size. This would give us the population parameter for the average height, which we write as mu h. This, however, is not practical for the entire Earth. First of all, that person probably can't go around and measure the height of every other person. Second, by the time they get to the last person, the population would have changed. People would have gotten taller, babies would be born, and there are any other number of complications. Pause the video here for a moment to think about how statisticians get around a problem like this and still manage to come to conclusions about entire populations. Welcome back from that pause. Hopefully you've come to the conclusion that, if you cannot determine the population mean by studying the entire population, you can try to estimate this by taking a manageable representative sample population and calculating an average height for them. This average height, taken from a smaller sample of the population, is referred to as a sample statistic, and for average height, we would write this as x bar h. If done properly, this sample statistic will offer a reasonable approximation of the true population parameter mu without having all the effort of hopelessly trying to perfectly capture the truth for every single person in a population. In general, population parameters, which represent ground truth, are often difficult or impossible to measure. This is where statistics becomes important. Sample statistics, combined with quantifiable and specific confidence intervals, provide bounded estimates for population parameters. The sample statistic is never guaranteed to be identical to the population parameter, but confidence intervals allow statisticians to say how likely the population parameter is to be within a certain range around the sample statistic. Let's start thinking about these confidence intervals and what they mean. The goal of taking a sample statistic and calculating confidence intervals is to be able to say with a certain level of assurance that the true parameter is within some range. Let's look at the pieces that go into confidence intervals. In general, a larger sample size, denoted as n, will lead to a better match between the sample statistic and the population parameter. The sample statistic itself can be any calculation done on a sample data set. For averages, that is denoted as x bar, while for proportions, this is written as p hat. Sometimes this can be calculated for differences in means or proportions, but that is just an extension of this basic principle. The confidence level C is a way to express how likely it is that the confidence level we are calculating does, in fact, include the population parameter within its bounds. For many purposes, the 95% confidence level is used. A 95% confidence level implies that the statistician is 95% certain that the real result is within the confidence interval. It does not say where, nor does it imply that it is exactly the sample statistic or near the bounds, just that it is somewhere within our bounds. Depending on the type of sample statistic and other features of the dataset, the confidence level will lead to a confidence level multiplier, which is based on the statistical distribution from which the sample data is drawn, usually a standard normal distribution, which yields a z-score, or a student's t-distribution, which leads to a t-statistic. Notationally, the confidence level is frequently associated with the value 1 minus alpha, which itself is the significance level. This is important when consulting lookup tables for multipliers. For example, a 95% confidence interval leads to a 5% significance level. Finally, there is the standard error, which can just be written as SE. This is generally a function of the sample statistic, some measurement of variance within the sample dataset, and the sample size. It will be different for every type of population parameter, but the concept is the same. In general, for some sample statistic, a confidence interval can be constructed as the sample statistic, plus or minus a multiplier, which is a function of the desired confidence and the relevant distribution, times the standard error, which is a function of the sample statistic, the sample variance, and the sample size. Rather than thinking too much about the exact form that this will take for various sample statistics, for now let's look at how we can interpret a confidence interval and think about some common mistakes. Recall our earlier example about the average height of the Earth's population. Let us imagine that our statistician has taken some time and has measured a sample statistic from 1,000 people and found that this sample has an average height of 72 inches. From here, he has also constructed a 95% confidence interval, which ranges from 69.5 to 74.5 inches. Notice how this interval is centered at 72 and goes 2.5 inches greater than and less than 72. What can we then say about mu h in this situation? Pause the video for a moment to think about this. Can we say that it is equal to 72 inches with some certainty, or only something about where it lies within the confidence interval? Welcome back from taking a moment to think about this. In general, the only thing that we can say about the population parameter is that there is some probability that it lies within the confidence interval. We can write this as follows. The probability that 69.5 is less than mu h and that mu h is less than 74.5 is equal to 95%. Of course, this means that there is a 5% chance that the true average height of the population is outside of these limits. Even if the sample was properly collected and the population was selected truly randomly, as is necessary when performing any such statistical calculations, it is possible that the confidence interval does not contain the population parameter. This is the sort of chance that statisticians take when performing such measurements. A confidence interval of 100% certainty would have to include all possible heights to guarantee that the parameter is within the range, which would defeat the purpose of any sample statistic in the first place. Statisticians must strike a balance between narrow estimates, which may be incorrect more often, and high confidence levels, which sometimes require intervals so large that they are no longer meaningful. In short, confidence intervals provide a range centered on a sample statistic in which a population parameter is likely to lie. They cannot determine an exact value of the population parameter, nor how close that parameter is exactly to the sample statistic, but only a probability that the parameter is in that range. Crucially, confidence intervals are not guarantees. Even a perfectly performed experiment can miss the true value of a population parameter, and any guarantee of 100% accuracy renders the confidence interval too large to be meaningful. Still, they can provide meaningful connections between statistics and the ground truth. Let's take a second to summarize what we've talked about here. First, we made a distinction between population parameters, which, while they are the real-world truth, are often impossible to measure, and sample statistics, which serve as our source of information about these parameters. Second, we introduced the need for confidence intervals to tie statistics back to population parameters. This included looking at the pieces of information needed from the sample data in order to calculate a confidence interval. Finally, we took a look at the basic structure of confidence intervals and then used an example of a confidence interval to understand how to interpret the meaning of a sample statistic and its confidence interval. Hopefully this has been a helpful introduction to the concepts of conditional probability and Bayes' theorem. You may encounter some more complicated problems with these concepts, but the basic principles will always be the same. Feel free to explore more areas like this on Chegg.